everybody, hey, let's stand together. We're going to worship the living God today, and I want to read 1 Chronicles 16:23 over us before we start singing. It says, sing to the Lord, all the earth, proclaim his salvation day after day. That's all of us today, that we're here to give him all the glory and all the praise, to sing to him with everything we've got. So let's do that together, church. See those hands up together.
We are a sea of voices. We are an ocean of your praise. Gathered under one name. We are a tide that's rising, and we cannot be contained. Gathered under one name. Oh, for a thousand times to sing the glories of our Lord God Almighty. Oh, to sing the Savior's praise, the triumph of his grace. You are worthy, you are worthy, God.
Let's rock.
Found our anthem at the cross where sin was slain. We're gathered under one name, where every chain is broken, every sorrow swept away. We're gathered.
Good. Oh.
This is true today. We can sing with confidence. You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let me down.
Death had claimed its victory. Divine King of love had given up his life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse is blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. But not the end, we could have known. For the earth began to shake.
'cause you're the name above all names.
So worthy, God.
You are worthy of all praise.
You're worthy, Lord.
And my heart will sing how great.
Church, we sing this. He is the name above every other name.
You're the name above all names.
So high and lifted up.
You are worthy of all praise.
Yes, you are.
My heart will sing how great is our God.
How great, how great. How great is our God,
and how great is our God. Would you sing with me?
How great
is our God, and all will see
how great is our God.
In response, we sing this old song. I will give you all my worship,
and I will give you all my worship, and I will give you all my praise, 'cause you alone I long to worship, you alone are worthy.
Sing that again.
I will give you everything, and I will give you all my worship, and I will give you all my
worship,
'cause you alone I long to worship, and you alone are worthy.
Jesus, you are worthy. You are worthy, God. Not just of our song, not just of this moment, God, but you are worthy of it all, over our whole life, over everything. All the earth declares your greatness. And in this moment, God, we say you are great and greatly to be praised. God, receive our worship. God, you are worthy, God. You're worthy over it all. We thank you that we can even have a time that we can give everything as a church to you, because you're worthy. You're worthy, you're worthy, you're worthy. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Can we give God a praise today that he's worthy of?
Good morning, church. Welcome to Harvest. It's great to have you in the house of the Lord. Bienvenidos a Harvest. Es un gusto que estén con nosotros esta mañana. My name is Christian. I have the privilege of serving as the campus pastor for Harvest en Español. Harvest en Español meets here at Rolling Meadows and at Elgin every single Sunday at 10 a.m. And on the last Sunday of the month, we come together because we are one body in Christ. Amen? Why don't you sit down? Have a seat. If this is your first time with us, we would love to meet you. We are so glad that you are here, and we would love to answer any questions that you might have. I will be outside in the lobby after the service if you have any questions for us. If you're from home, please fill out the Connect card in our new app, Church Center. Is the best way for us to know how to pray for you, how to minister to you, how to be a blessing to you and to your family this morning. We're beginning a new series today. Today we launch it. It's called Intended for Good. And for the next 6 weeks, we are going to look into the life of Joseph from the book of Genesis. And we are going to see how in the midst of difficult circumstances and things that sometimes we do not understand, the Lord is working everything for his purposes. And so we pray that this is going to be a blessing to you and to your family and to our church. Genesis 50:20 says this, "As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring about that many people should be kept alive as they are today." We are really praying that this is going to be an awesome moment for us as a church to trust more in the Lord and what he is doing for us. We usually pray for local churches around. Today we're going a little further than that. We're going to be praying for missionaries. Missionaries are the people that go wherever the Lord calls them to bring the gospel to those places. Sometimes it's local. I have many friends who are local missionaries, but also many that are in faraway places, giving up comfort and being around their families in order to bring the gospel to those communities. And we'll be praying for them this morning as well in a little bit. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 18 through 19 says, "They are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, thus storing up treasures for themselves as a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is truly life." 1 Timoteo 6, 18 al 19 nos dice, "Que hagan bien, que sean ricos en buenas obras, dadivosos, generosos, atesorando para sí buen fundamento para lo que va a venir, que echen mano de la vida eterna." The Lord has called us to be generous with everything that we have. On the screen, you're going to see ways that you can be generous today, but throughout this week, we only reflect what the Lord has done for us, and we are generous with everything that he has given for us today. And so as a community, as a church, we want to be more generous. It's one of our goals, to be more generous, and we pray that that will be the case for you as well. Would you please join me in prayer this morning? Father God, it's so good to be in your house, Lord. It's so good to be with the people of God, worshiping you for who you are and what you have done. You alone are worthy of our worship. You alone is the one that we come to seek, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be here today to worship you. Lord, we pray for all those missionaries serving you in many places around the world. May you provide for them. May we be generous with them and for them. Bless the efforts that they are putting in many places around the world, Lord. May you protect them and be with them wherever they are, Lord. We pray for today. May this new series be a blessing to our church. May we grow in our understanding of who you are, and may it lead us to worship you and to trust you in the middle of hard circumstances. Thank you, Lord. Holy Spirit, take control of this place and prepare our hearts to hear from you this morning. It is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen and amen. Would you please turn around and welcome somebody to church this morning as we get ready to hear God's word.
Good to see you. How are you? It's great to be in Elgin today. Hope you're doing really well. You need a Bible. Do you ever need a Bible? Genesis 37. So if you're new to the church or new to the church generally, so the church harvest or the church generally, or maybe just kind of new to the Bible, the Genesis is the first book in the Bible, so it's really easy to get to. If you have a Bible, you can just turn there. If you don't have a Bible, we want to give you one. Look, free Bible day. So you just need to see somebody outside, and we'll give you a really great Bible, and you can follow along that way. I've got some of the stuff on the screen here, and you can follow along today. There's going to be a really good story that we're going to walk through here in the next few minutes. Before we do that, though, I have breaking news, all right? I don't know if you know this, but a week from Tuesday, we're electing a president. Did you know that? Have you been aware that somebody called it election season? Now, it used to be election day when I was a kid, but now it's election season. I would like to go back to day because season stinks. I like the seasons of fall and winter and spring and summer, but I do not like the season of election. It's frustrating. I feel like everyone's holding their breath because no matter what happens, no matter who is elected, half of the population of the United States is going to lose their mind. If you are a big supporter of former President Donald Trump, you believe that if Vice President Kamala Harris wins, then democracy is over and it will never come back. If, on the other hand, you're a supporter of Kamala Harris and Donald Trump wins, then you believe that democracy is over and it will never come back. I follow a lot of news. I like politics. I find it interesting in the same way that I like watching train wrecks. They keep you interested, and people freak out over sometimes small things. And of course, it's important. Of course, the election's important. And so that's why I've decided for the next 2 weeks to tell you exactly who to vote for. No, I will not. Some of you were like, finally, this church, you know, and others were like, I'm leaving. Don't worry, not going to do that at all, but I do want to talk to you about a way to get some perspective when we live in such a tense moment. How do we remove ourselves from the forest, the trees, and be able to look at the forest? How do we lift ourselves above the fray and be able to say we can find peace knowing that God is king? And it doesn't matter who the president is, it doesn't matter who the prime ministers of the world are, or whether or not they meet in Davos or some other place in Switzerland or Belgium or the United States, it doesn't matter. That God is working out his promises to his people, just like he has throughout all the ages. And even though it feels like we're in chaos, everything's happening exactly the way he had planned it. I want to remind you of that. I actually want to spend the next several weeks reminding you of that by telling you a story. It is a great story. This is going to be like a mini-series. And by mini-series, I mean the one that you kind of go and you watch on TV. And each week, you left with a bit of a cliffhanger because you want to hear the next part of it. But it's one of the great stories of the Bible. It's a story about a guy named Joseph. And the story has lots of twists and turns. It has lots of crazy things happening. There's jealousy and revenge and attempted murder and sexual tension and politics and plot twists. And all of it highlights the power of God over history. So it's an appropriate thing to talk about during election season. I'm excited about it, really excited about what's going to happen in the next few weeks. So today, I want to do the first installment of that, and I want to just introduce you to Joseph and to what his family is like. They are not doing well. They are a fairly odd family, and in Genesis 37, this entire chapter kind of describes how odd they are. So what I want to do, and here's kind of the approach, if you like to get outlines and know exactly where we are going to be on our little journey here, I want to tell you this story kind of in full, and then I want to, at the end, just give a few brief applications, all right? But the guts of this is about the story itself. So let's jump into it. Genesis 37, verse 1. Jacob lived in the land of his father's sojournings. His meanderings, you know, sometimes some of you have lived in different places in Chicagoland we would say you sojourned in Chicagoland. Well, Jacob had lived in lots of places in this particular region. It's in the land of Canaan, which would eventually become the promised land, right? So he's there. These are well before the days of Moses and coming across the Red Sea and Joshua going into the promised land. This is way, way further back than that. Jacob actually is the son of a guy named Isaac, who is the son of Abraham. So let's locate ourselves in the grand story of the Bible, okay? So here we are. We've got Abe is chosen by, that looks like Ade. Abe is chosen by God out of all the peoples of the earth. And God says, look, I'm going to rescue the people in the world. I'm going to rescue them through you. This is my plan. Sin has taken over, but my plan is I'm going to choose you to be a special nation in possession. Now, he's an old guy at the time, and he was married to his wife, Sarah. And Sarah was, she was really old. And so the idea that she and him in this old age were going to have a baby who was then going to lead, you know, going to multiply into generations and generations, so many kids or offspring that they'd have, you know, be like as numerous as the stars in the sky or the sand on the seashore. That was a crazy thought to them. If you are in your latter years here, you're 80 or 90, if you had an angel come and show up to you today and say, you're going to have another baby, you'd be like, right, that's going to happen. No, it's not. But they said, look, okay, fine. We're going to have to figure out how to do this on our own. Because God must have this. Great that God wants this, he has this in mind. It's just we're going to have to figure out how it is that we can fulfill his plan for him. And so they go, and Sarah's like, I'm not going to have any kids. But you can, if you go and you sleep with my servant, Hagar, then you can have a baby. And they did. This was the plan, you know? Sleep with the baby, sleep with Hagar and have the baby. The baby's name was Ishmael. We'll just call him Ish. All right? God comes along and says, that's not the plan. That wasn't what I had said. I promised you to have a child. I was going to give you a child, and I'm going to give you a child. And the child's going to be someone, it's going to be a miracle. And so he comes along, and his name is Isaac. Isaac and Ishmael are, of course, brothers. Now, Isaac is the son of the promise. He is the one through whom the promises of Abraham will be fulfilled. He ends up having a couple of kids himself. He has his son Jacob, and he has a son named Esau. Esau is the older one. He's the one who, he's called Esau actually because it means red. And they named him that because when he was born, he came out and he looked like a Wookiee, right? He came out and he was like hairy, just red. So his name's going to be Esau. It's an interesting thing that happened when he was born, though, is that they were pulling him out, right? You've got a baby. His name, he's really red and hairy. And they're like, name him Red. Okay? But grabbing onto his heel as if trying to pull him back into the birth canal so that his twin, Jacob, could be first was Jacob. And this is a great picture of what they become. The oldest, who has the right of the blessing in that culture, he doesn't really care too much about the blessing, but Jacob cares a lot about it. And Jacob tries to get the blessing by pulling his brother back his whole life. He makes him some stew on one occasion and says he'll give it to him if Esau's willing to sell his birthright to Jacob. And Esau is such a compulsive guy. He's like, I'm so starving, I will sell you anything, even my birthright. And Jacob gets the birthright. Later on in his life, when his father, Isaac, is near death, actually, and he's blind, Jacob weasels his way with the help of his mother. He weasels his way into getting the birthright officially by basically putting an animal skin on him, so he felt really hairy. His father was basically blind at the time. And he pretended to be Esau so that he could get the blessing. And his blind father bought it and was like, yeah, I'll bless you. He's a manipulator, Jacob. In fact, if you read through the book of Genesis, you're like, how in the world is this Jacob guy any part of God's family? He's a total jerk. And yet he is. He's chosen by God. Well, Jacob ends up having his own children, right? He's married, in fact, to, we'll take him over here. He's married to two ladies, Leah and Rachel. Just can I say really quickly, the Bible doesn't endorse polygamy. It describes it. It's different. In fact, everywhere you see polygamy show up, it causes all sorts of horrible, horrible problems. So you should learn the lesson from the examples. That one wife, good. Two, that's a good. Amen. Gentlemen are like, yep. So he marries these two. Now, the way these two came into the situation is a little bit weird. Jacob fell in love with Rachel. He just was so smitten by her. And on their wedding night, their father, Leah and Rachel's father, he decided to do a little snookering of his own because he wanted his oldest daughter to get married first so that, you know, honor and all that kind of stuff. He didn't want his second daughter to get married, and that's what was happening. And so he got Jacob good and drunk over the wedding, and then that night when it was time to consummate the marriage, he took drunk Jacob, put him in the tent, and he sent in Leah. And now she's Jacob's bride. Jacob wakes up the next morning and is like, wait a minute, what? And Leah's there. And he's like, no, I thought this was Rachel. He goes to his father-in-law and says, what are you doing? And he's like, hey man, it's not my fault that you got good and drunk and did this, and it's not appropriate anyway for you to marry the second without the first. So you get both of them now, but now you gotta work for me for like 14 years to get them both. Sorry. Which is funny in a little way, ironic funny, because Jacob, who's been manipulating everyone and trying to mess everybody's life up by you know, trying to seek out his own ways, is finally getting it back a little bit from his father-in-law. Anyway, Rachel and Leah have eventually 12 kids. Not just them. They have servants, and they have kids as well. And all of those kids are basically the children of Jacob. Rachel, her firstborn, though, is a guy named Joseph. And that's who the story's about. By the way, you're wondering, why did you go into all that detail? Because this sounds like an Italian crime family. Doesn't it? I mean, like, you're at some point, you're like, oh, when the Godfather is in it somewhere in here. And the story that we're reading then is about the generations of Jacob, meaning this is about Jacob's family. And so you got the whole lineage there, and now you've got a story about Jacob and his sons. At this point, he's only got 11 of them. The 12th is yet to be born. And only one of those sons was born to his true love, Rachel. So with that background, you can walk into the passage understanding what's going to be described. Joseph, being 17 years old, very important in my opinion, because much of what this guy does right now is the kind of thing a 17-year-old does, all right? If you know 17-year-olds, or if you're 17 right now, I'm sorry. This is the way many in the world view you, because you can kind of be full of yourself sometime when you're 17. I mean, I was. You probably aren't, but I was. He was 17 years old, and he was pasturing the flock with his brothers. He was a boy with the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah. Now, these were two of the wives. They were, one of them was a servant of Leah, and one of them was a servant of Rachel, and of course, that's the way it worked in those days, is that if your wives had servants, they were also your wives, and you could sleep with them, and their kids were your kids. So he's with his half-brothers. working out there. He's basically working with his half-brothers. And Joseph brought a bad report of them, these half-brothers, to their father. This bad report, we don't know exactly what it was, but they're out doing the farming stuff or whatever. Maybe they took a nap on a Tuesday morning when they were supposed to be gathering wheat. Maybe they didn't shear the sheep appropriately or whatever. These brothers of Joseph were like, man, it's not a big deal. And Joseph was like, it is a big deal, and I'm telling Daddy. Now, you need to understand that Israel, this is another name for Jacob, Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other sons. Of course he did. He was the son of Rachel, his true love, the only son of Rachel, the only one. Because he was a son of his old age, and he made him a robe of many colors. Robes like this were meant to signify someone's position in the household. So there are other places in the Bible where somebody who is given a robe is she's a princess, and she gets to wear a robe because it signifies that she's actually more important than everybody else in the household. Well, this is essentially what his dad does. He's like, well, look, all of you guys are my kids, but this one kid, this Joseph, he's a special kid to me. Son of my old age, of my true love. So I'm going to give him this cool coat. Do you like your coat, Joseph? I love my coat. In fact, Joseph loved the coat so much that he would walk around with the coat. And he'd say to his brothers things like, do you have a coat like this? I have a coat like this. Have you ever seen a coat like this? Do you notice how many colors there are? You're wearing earth tones, and I'm wearing pastels. So. When his brothers saw, and of course they saw it. They saw it every time he wore the coat. When they saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him. And he couldn't speak peacefully to him. Every time Joseph walked in, it was like, oh, man. Best thing to do is just to keep quiet or to tell him what you think of him a little bit. We don't like you, Joseph. We don't like the way you act. We don't like the way that you think of yourself. Always thinking you're better than us. And of course he thought he was better than them because he was told his whole life that he was better than them. Now Joseph had a dream. And when he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. So he has this dream. I'm sure that you've had dreams before in the middle. And I take this medication for my heart that apparently, that is one of the side effects is it gives me these really vivid dreams. So sometimes I wake up in the morning, I'm like, Jeannie, you will not believe what my dream was. And it's about people I haven't thought of for years and years in the past. Now, you and I, when we hear dreams like that, we're like, oh, that's so weird. It must have been a bad burrito or the medicine or whatever it was that you something went wrong in your body. That's because we tend to be what we call secularists. We don't see dreams as being things that were communicating to us information from God. But in this day, dreams were always given by the gods. That's how they would communicate. So when he shows up and he says, I got a dream, it's basically him saying, hey guys, God talked to me last night, and you know what he told me? He said to them, hear the dream that I dreamed. Behold, okay, this means check it out. We were binding sheaves in the field, okay? We're out wheat with the wheat, and we're gathering the sheaves together, and we're putting them together, okay? And my sheaf stood upright, tall. And behold, check it out. Your sheaves gathered around it and bowed low to my sheaf. So I'm here with my coat, and you guys are bowing down the way slaves would bow to their master. Cool dream, huh, guys? And his brothers said to him, are you indeed to reign over us? Or are you indeed to rule over us? Isn't that great, by the way? They say it twice. One, are you indeed to reign over us? Or are you indeed to rule over us? Because that's what you do when you're very upset with someone else. You don't just say, you don't just ask the question, the rhetorical question once. You ask it twice. What'd you say? What'd you say? Oh, is that what you think? Is that what you think? Right? And so that's what they're asking. Hey, say it to my face. You gonna say it right here to my face? They hated him even more. How many times can you hate him more? You get the picture, right? They hated him, and then they hated him more, and now they hate him really, really more. Because of his words. And then he dreamed another dream. And he told it to his brothers. He doesn't learn the first lesson, which is maybe don't share the dreams with your brothers, dude. It's cool to have the dreams, but they wouldn't respond really well the first time. But now you're going to tell it to your brothers again. And he's like, I'm 17. And he said, behold, check it out. I've dreamed another dream. And check it out. This time, the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars were bowing down to me. My dream was cosmic. That's how grand I am. But when he told it to his father and his brothers, his father rebuked him and said to him, what are you doing, man? What is this dream that you've dreamed? Do you honestly think that I and your mother and your brothers will come to bow ourselves to the ground before you? Is this really what you think? I know you have the code. I know I love you, Joseph. But is this really what you think? And his brothers were jealous of him. But his father kept the saying in mind. Now, of course, his father kept the saying of mind because he knows that these dreams are from someone, right? Who gives dreams? The Lord does. So he dwells on it a little bit. His brothers hate him. All right, that's the whole setting of the family dynamic. Would you love to have Thanksgiving with these people? It would be fantastic. You just sit there and be with your popcorn the whole time. Like, oh yeah, this is gonna be good. Now his brothers went to pasture their father's flock near Shechem. Shechem was about, this was about 50 to 60 miles away. So if we were gonna travel from the northern part of Chicagoland, this would basically take us over the Wisconsin border. But you don't have a car, you would go there walking, following sheep. Okay, or gathering them, so it's slow. It would probably take a week for you to do this. So they're a week's journey away. And Israel, Jacob, said to Joseph, are not your brothers pasturing the flock at Shechem? Come, I'll send you to them. I mean, it's before the days of cell phones, of course, or any kind of courier or anything. So I want to know what's going on. I need to check on, make sure that everybody's doing their job and stuff. So I need to send you out there, Joseph. And he said to him, yeah, here I am, ready to go. So he said, go now, see if it's well with your brothers and with the flock and bring me word. So he sent him from the valley of Hebron and he came to Shechem. Now, I've got to tell you something really important before we get to this right here. The last time that the people of Israel were in Shechem, things didn't go that well. Shechem actually is the name of a guy. He was the prince of that area. Shechem fell deeply in lust for Dinah, who was the daughter of Jacob. So she was the sister of all these brothers. And Shechem, one of the people of the land, the prince of the land, was so enamored with her that he kind of coaxed her to come and talk to him, and he walked her into his tent, and he had his way with her. He's the prince, after all. He can do these sorts of things. Now, after he had his way with her, he was so intoxicated by her, he said, I've got to have her. She has to be my wife. Now, he had lots of other wives, but I got to have this one. I got to have this one. Dad, he goes to his dad, the king, I have to have this one. Give her to me. His dad's like, cool. In order for her to be your wife, though, we've got to go and make a deal with these Israelites. So let me go talk to Jacob. So he does. He walks, wanders over, talks to Jacob. Hey, Jacob, here's the deal. We want to intermarry with you. We want to make sure that your daughters and our sons can be married so that they can have offspring. It'll be a peace agreement between the two of us. We'll actually be together, a pretty powerful nation. Can you do this with me? Okay, says Jacob. But the only way for us to give our daughters to your sons is if your sons are circumcised, which they're not, so bummer. Well, Shechem finds out about this command, and he's like, he's the prince. He can order everyone around. Okay, fine. I love her so much. I want her so badly. Everyone's getting circumcised. All the men cowered, you know, shiver went through their spine. But everyone obeyed. Okay, we're going to get circumcised. Now, you guys, you brothers of Dinah, you can come and stay in our land, and you hang out with us for a little while. We're going to do the circumcision thing, and then when we're much better, I'm going to have Dinah, and everything will be happy, okay? Yes. Oh, everything will be happy. So they go, they get circumcised, all of these adult males, and here's what happens. On the third day, this is Genesis 35, on the third day when they were sore, two of the sons of Jacob, Simeon and Levi, Dinah's brothers, took their swords and came against the city while it felt secure, and he killed all the males. They killed Hamor and his son Shechem with the sword and took Dinah out of Shechem's house and went away. The sons of Jacob came upon the slain and plundered the city because they had defiled their sister. They took their flocks and their herds, their donkeys, and whatever was in the city and in the field. All of their wealth, all their little ones, all their wives, all that was in the houses, they captured and they plundered. Fast forward, not very long. And his brothers went to shepherd their father's flock near Shechem. And Israel says, hey, go and find the guys at Shechem. And he comes to Shechem, Joseph does, and a man found him wandering in the fields. This man is from Shechem. There's a man who probably knew all the dudes who had been circumcised and killed, and he knows that his prince had been murdered in the midst of this despicable act by these Jewish men. And there they are. And there's little Joseph wandering in the fields. I have to ask you, if you're the guy from Shechem, what are you doing here? Are you going to be like, let's go bring him cookies? I should go out and welcome him into my house. Remember last time what happened when they welcomed the people into their homes? So what you expect right here is this dude from Shechem to go right out there and go, hey, I've got something for you. You're done. He's a week away from his father. He knows the brothers, this guy from Shechem, as you'll see, knows the brothers have gone on another day's journey. These kids all alone. And the man asked him, hey, what are you looking for? He said, I'm seeking my brothers, he said. Tell me, please, where they're pasturing the flock. And the man said, dude, this is the tension in this scene. You're expecting the guy just to come out with a knife right here. And the man said, oh, they've gone away. I heard them say, let's go to Dothan, which is another like 10 to 15 miles north. So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. Nothing happened. Here's the crazy part. Why is this guy in the story? Well, because the one from whom you expect violence shows kindness. But the ones from whom you expect kindness, his brothers, you get violence. On the third day, they saw him from afar. His brothers saw him from afar. Out in Dothan, and before he came near to them, they conspired against him to kill him. You guys see him? He's over there. Check him out. What should we do? What should we do? You ever had wanted to play a prank on your friend? Oh, here he comes. Get the string. Spray it at him, you know? What are we going to do? Let's kill him. Remember, their hatred is grown and grown and grown and grown. Let's kill him. They said to one another, here comes this dreamer. Remember the stupid dreams? We can put an end to his dream, to whatever message he thinks he got from whatever God. We can put an end to it right here. Let's kill him and it'll be all done. Come now, let's kill him and throw him into one of the pits. These pits were cisterns. They held water. They were about 6 feet deep to 10 feet deep, and they were shaped kind of like a bottle, right? So narrow at the top and then big at the bottom. They ended up becoming, in later years, prisons. That's how they got repurposed. Let's throw him into one of the pits, and then we'll say that a fierce animal's devoured him, and we'll see what will become of his dreams. Everything's about the dreams. But when Reuben heard it, now Reuben is the oldest. Reuben is the first son of Leah. And he is the one who's responsible for family when they're out in the fields. So if dad's not around, the oldest son, he's in charge. And Reuben heard the plan, and he rescued him out of their hands, saying, whoa, 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 whoa. Let's not take his life. Instead, here's what we can do. We're going to shed no blood, but we can throw him into this pit here in the wilderness and not lay a hand on him. Guys, it's basically the same goal in the end. You know you want him to die and stuff, but we don't need to like shed his blood. We can just leave him here. And then he'll be done. I mean, who cares what happens to him after that? But he has a secret plan himself. It's that he might rescue him out of their hand to restore him to his father. See, here's the thing with Reuben. He's the firstborn son. He should be the one who's highly favored. He's not. Instead, it's Joseph. And so his plan here is, look, I don't want him to die. What we'll do is we'll throw him into this pit, and then he's thinking, you guys will go back and you'll report to dad that he's gone. We don't know what happened to him. And when you leave, I'm gonna come back around, grab him out of the pit, and I'm gonna follow you maybe a day's journey behind, and you guys are gonna tell dad, and he's gonna be so horribly sad until I show up with Joseph and walk into the room and say, look what I found. And my dad will finally love me. He'll finally be proud of me. I won't be a letdown to him anymore. So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him. The phrase here that's used is used of skinning animals. So it's a violent act. They grab him, they strip him of his robe and the robe of many colors that he wore, and they took him and they threw him into the pit. Now the pit was empty. There was no water in it. And then they sat down to eat, because that's what you do when your brother's screaming for his life right next to you, right? Honestly, that little phrase right there is like the most calloused thing, isn't it? If you're worried about anything in your life, you find it hard to eat. But these guys don't find it hard to eat. They're like, we killed our brother. Let's have something to eat. You got any food? Despicable. They hate him. They don't care one bit about him. But looking up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites. Remember Ishmael? Isaac's brother all those years ago. Well, his descendants. And they're coming from Gilead with their camels bearing gum, balm, and myrrh. They're traders, and they're on their way to carry it down to Egypt. And then Judah said to his brothers, ooh, 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 ooh. What prophet, and I mean prophet, what prophet is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Look, let's sell him to the Ishmaelites and let not our hand be upon him. For like he's our brother after all, our own flesh. So he's making it sound like, hey, I care about the guy. He didn't care about the guy. He's probably got a mouth full of food. He's our brother. Let's not kill him. What he wants is money. Guys, if we're going to go through with this, we might as well make a little bit of dough on the side, you know, so that we can buy coats. And his brothers listened to him. And then the Midianite traders, the Ishmaelites, passed by, and they drew Joseph up, and they lifted him out of the pit. And they sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 shekels of silver, and they took Joseph to Egypt. When Reuben returned, apparently he had gone off and waited for them to leave him in the pit, and then he was expecting them to be gone. But when he returned to the pit, he saw that Joseph was not in the pit. And he tore his clothes and he returned to his brothers and he said, the boy's gone and I, where shall I go? Do you not realize what you've done? You've ruined my plan, my only hope for my father loving me. And then they took Joseph's robe and slaughtered a goat and dipped the robe in blood, and they sent the robe of many colors and brought it to their father. And they said, through others, right? They had it brought. This is what we found. Please identify whether it is your son's robe. He's not our brother. He's your son. Is it your son's robe or not? And he identified it and said, it is my son's robe. A fierce animal has devoured him. Well, close, Jacob. It wasn't an animal. It was actually some fierce animals who had done it. Joseph, who was out without doubt torn to pieces. And then Jacob tore his garments and put sackcloth on his loins and mourned for the son for many days. And all his sons and all his daughters rose up to comfort him. Dad, it's going to be okay. You have, look at all the other kids that you have. Focus on the future. It's not going to be always like this. But he refused to be comforted. And he said, no, I'm going to go down to Sheol to my son. This was the place of the dead. I'm going to die in this state. Don't try to comfort me. I've lost the son of my one true love. Don't you see? Thus his father wept for him. But meanwhile, the Midianites had sold him in Egypt to Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, the captain of the guard. You should come back next week. You should, seriously. Like, there's other stuff that happens. He's in Egypt. He's going to end up meeting Pharaoh. Wait, do you see what happens when he meets Pharaoh? But it's not going to be for a minute because he's going to go hang out with Potiphar, and his wife is a mess. You should come back. We really should. All right, before we're done here, got about 8 minutes here, and I want to give you a couple of applications to this story. Here's the first. Seemingly small sins grow big problems. Seemingly small sins grow big problems. Like, it's weird reading it, isn't it? I mean, you just look at the dysfunction in the passage. It's like looking, it's actually like looking at a full-grown garden and wondering, where did all these weeds come from? And the answer is actually from what came before. The reason I spent so much time at the beginning of this giving you kind of the context was not just because of the context and not just because I wanted to describe some weird family to you. What I wanted you to see was actually what these people are experiencing in this present time is a result of some really bad, bad decisions. Even though maybe they were insignificant to the people who were making them, they were really bad decisions early on. You say, what kinds of bad decisions? Well, Jacob's favoritism poisons his kids. It destroys. Reuben is dripping with the poison. Why is Reuben doing what he's doing? Why does he act the way he does? Because he is desperate for his father's approval and love, but he can't get it because his father thinks, hey, what's the big deal, man? So I love my son of my one true love better than everyone else. So what? Not a big deal. I want to give him a coat. What's wrong with giving him a coat? Because all the others are going to see what you're doing, and it's going to sow this discord among them that it's going to grow into a full flower. And when that full flower shows up, Jacob, do you not realize how bad this could get? Now, Jacob could respond at this point and saying, hey, man, I'm just doing what my parents did. And he'd be right. His parents did the same thing, right? I mean, like, what you've got before him is Esau was treated better by his father, Isaac, than Joseph was treated. Or sorry, than Jacob was treated. I'm quite sure that when Isaac is treating Esau and Jacob differently. And the reason he's doing it, right? He's like, well, I just like Esau because he's a more manly man. Jacob is not, he's just not that manly. He likes hanging out with his mom all the time. I like to go hunting. What's wrong with that? I like to hang out with a dude. What's wrong with that? When I sit down with my other son, he just wants to talk about art and stuff. What's wrong with me just getting along better with this other one, with Esau? Because, man, don't you realize this small thing that you think is so insignificant in the present moment is going to grow into this enormous garden of weeds? People are going to die because of your dumb favoritism. That's why it's a big deal. You know, Leah and Rachel, one of the big things that happens between Leah and Rachel is that Leah mocks Rachel because Rachel can't have kids. The one job that a woman had in those days was to have kids, especially boys, so that you could carry on the farm and the name. Rachel can't have any, and Leah can have kids like crazy. And every time she has a child, she goes over to her sister, I'm winning. Sorry, I'm winning. You're not as good as I am. But of course, the reason that Leah is doing this is because her dumb father slipped her in unnoticed. But don't you see that her father's like, hey, I'm doing a good thing, right? I'm trying to get you married off. It's not a significant sin. We've got to figure out a way to fulfill God's promises, says Abraham and Sarah. And so they're like, well, we should just give you over. I mean, Sarah's like, we should just give you over to Hagar. You can have a kid with her. You know, spits back, done. Don't you, listen, the point that I'm trying to make is that this entire passage is screaming. The dysfunction that you're seeing is the product of some really bad yet thought to be insignificant decisions made years ago. You do realize that you and I are making decisions right now and giving ourselves excuses for them, even though they're not significant. We're like, well, it's not a big deal. You know, here's the reasons. I grew up this way, or I have this background, or whatever. I feel this way, or I have mental health problems this way. And I'm gonna make a bunch of decisions right now that might not be perfect, but they're the best that I can do, and I have to be me. You're making those decisions now, and your grandchildren are gonna pay for it. Some of you are the grandchildren who are paying for it. The future fields of our lives are a product of what we sow now. The destinations we arrive at are the result of the courses we plot now. And sometimes I wish, I honestly wish I could take one of those little cameras into some of the counseling discussions I've had before. You'd be shocked at the kinds of things that happen in churches among Christians. And pastors who go and sit down and they try to make sense of it, and you're sitting with a guy who just thought, well, it wasn't a big deal when I was, you know, 15 to look at pornography, and I started looking at it just a little bit, not very frequently, and I don't even look at it that frequently now, but my wife hates me now because she thinks I don't love her. Yeah, she does feel that way. Well, it's not a big deal, but dude, it is a big deal. It is a big deal. Your decision to sit down and to look at your computer late at night at women who are not your wife is actually going to sow a kind of weed in the lives of your grandkids if you don't turn away from it. Well, maybe not. Dude, it happens all the time. And you're counting on your ability to hide it. That's basically it. But I'm going to tell you, man, the truth will find out. It does. It just does. You know how we sometimes sit and we watch those crazy family shows? You know, Real Housewives of Detroit or whatever. You know, or whatever. The reason we watch it is, and the reason they're popular is because we feel like when we're watching them, we're seeing somebody who at least I'm not as bad as that. At least I'm not doing those things. At least it makes us feel better. You know, historically, the ancients used to call those stories tragedies. And the role of a tragedy is to try to teach you something. It's supposed to give you like an ethical instruction. You're supposed to watch it and be like, I don't want to be like that. And then you're supposed to walk away, and when you face situations where the people in the play or in the show have made decisions that you shouldn't make, you're supposed to face those other decisions that in your life that are similar and say, I don't want to make those. And yet, I got to tell you, I've spent enough time as a pastor, there's so many Christians making the same stupid decisions that people in succession make. Or people in the weird housewives of whatever make. The beauty of being a Christian and the beauty of coming to church every week is I get the opportunity to basically tell you, hey, there's an off-ramp to this whole way of life. You know that, right? Every week, I get to construct an off-ramp. I get to say, Jesus is inviting you to get off at this stop. There's a love's travel stop right here. And you can get off and you can wipe away all of that sin and start to deal with the consequences that have been building up. But better now than later on when the weeds are fully grown. There's always forgiveness available. There's always a way out. Always a way out. My job as a pastor is to remind you that the one who provides it invites you to come. Secondly and finally, though, a seemingly invisible God can be seen if you just know how to look. You notice whose name doesn't show up in this thing? The Lord our God. He's not there. And yet he's there. He's everywhere. I mean, he gives a dream to Joseph, knowing that Joseph, who is full of himself because of what he's received from his father, is going to share it with his brothers and be a 17-year-old about it and be all... He actually helps, God does, Joseph find his brothers through this kind Shechemite. Do you know how many other Shechemites he could have come across who would not have been kind? He didn't even need to have Joseph found by anybody. Joseph could have been wandering around there for a long time and just gone home. But the Lord provides a person to get him to the destination where he gets killed, or almost. But when he's out there, God uses Reuben and Reuben's massive father wound to stop the actual murder. And then he uses Judah's greed to sell him on to so that he can end up getting into Egypt, where, and don't tell anyone I told you, he ends up becoming prime minister and saving the lives of all these people who nearly killed him. The providence of God, his hand, the invisible hand of God, is working through all of these circumstances like they're little threads, and he is drawing them through, and he's going to tie them up into the most magnificent tapestry you've ever seen. God takes the sinful choices of sinful people and he uses them for his glory and our good. Look, that means that if you're a Christian, no matter how much garbage you've experienced in your life or created in your life, God can and will grow flowers out of it. If there's one thing I can say about everybody who's here, we are two things simultaneously. We are sinners and sufferers all the time. Sinners and sufferers. We tend to focus on the suffering and the ways that we've been wrong and the way that we've been victimized. And we say, look at all these hard things that people have done to me in my life. The ways that my parents treated me, or the way that my family treats me, or the way that my husband or wife treats me, or the way that my job treats me. I have been wronged. And we have a list, like a litany of examples of ways that we have been oppressed in our lives. And we talk about them. Our culture is like that. We like to talk about how we've been victimized. And they're all true. Abuse, neglect, all sorts of terrible things have happened to you in your life. But at the same time, you and I are also the ones who victimize. I was riding my bike here to this morning and thinking about to myself about all the different ways that I have inadvertently or advertently acted in ways that are beneath the call of Christ. It's a sickening list. So many failures, so many ways that I've wronged other people. I am both a sufferer at the hands of those who are victimizing me, and I am a sinner, the one who is doing the victimizing. The beauty of this story is it doesn't matter who you are in the story. It doesn't matter if you've done right all the time or if you do wicked all the time. God takes the wicked and he takes the right and he brings them all to a conclusion of beauty for all the ones in it. Even the evil acts that people do are the very acts that God intends for good. Are they evil? Yes. But intended for good. So you are supposed to, at the end of it, put yourself in Joseph's shoes as he's sitting there bouncing around in the caravan, thinking to himself, how is this ever going to end well? Some of you feel like you're bouncing around in the caravan of your life in this moment. And you're wondering, how in the world is this ever going to end well? But I know the whole story. Not just with this story, I know the whole story of Scripture. I'm just gonna tell you, we win. That this moment that you're in, yeah, it's a bad chapter, baby. You bounce in there. But the author who's written the story says there's more to come. You should come back and find out what that is. It can end well. It will end well, no matter who the president is. Let me pray. Father, I'm thankful for your grace and for the knowledge of your sovereignty and power over all things. I pray that our time spent in your word over the next few weeks when it comes to this story would be time that is not just well spent, but that you would use in our lives to reaffirm to us your commitment to us, your ability to work things out in ways that we never even imagined. And I pray, Father, that you would give us perspective on the challenges that we face in the present moment. Thank you. We thank you for our Lord Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Church, we're not done yet. We're going to share a time of communion. We're going to enter into a time of communion. It's our time to remember what the Lord has done for us by dying on the cross. Vamos a tener un tiempo de comunión. Vamos a tener el tiempo de la Santa Cena para compartir. I'm going to ask all the ushers to come up. In a little minute, they are going to pass all the elements. And we ask you to take the time right now to just be reminded of who you are in Christ and what he did for us. There are many times that we feel like Joseph, and so we need to be reminded, like Philippians 1:6 reminds us. I'm sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Christ. Filipenses 1:6 nos recuerda que el que comenzó en vosotros la buena obra la perfeccionará hasta el día de Cristo. And maybe you're here this morning and you relate to Joseph and what he's going through. And we want to just remind you that if you're breathing, the Lord is still working in your life and he's going to complete what he has done. And so we want you to hold on to that and to be reminded that there is hope and that hope is found in Jesus Christ. But also if you are here and you have not put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, we ask you to let those elements pass, but also to take the time to think about that hope that we find in him. And we pray that that might be true for you today. We're just going to pray, play some music right now. There's not going to be any lyrics. But we want you to take the time to just do business with the Lord. Think about his goodness. Think about his faithfulness. Think about his love for you. I was also asked to remind you, if you need gluten-free communion, there's some in the back. If that's something that it's something that you need, please feel free. We want you to participate in this. But as you sit there, take the time to think about what the Lord is doing in your life and what he's calling you to do. Vamos a tener este tiempo, vamos a tomar, tan solo vamos a tocar la música y queremos que usted tenga el tiempo para pensar en su relación con el Señor. Piense en su fidelidad, en lo bueno que él ha sido, en el amor que le ha demostrado. Tome su tiempo para conversar con el Señor. I'll read in English and then I'll read in Spanish and then we will take the elements together. Mark 14 tells us this. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given it thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take it, this is my body." Mientras comían, Jesús tomó pan y lo bendijo, luego lo partió y se lo dio a ellos, diciéndoles, "Tomen, esto es mi cuerpo." Let's take it together. This is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many, he said to them. Truly I tell you, I will not drink it again from the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God. Esto es mi sangre del pacto que es derramada por muchos, dijo, les aseguro que no volveré a beber del fruto de la vida hasta aquel día en que bebe el nuevo vino en el reino de Dios. Let's take it. Would you please stand up? We're going to continue to worship.
Amen.
The Lord is faithful, so constant and so true. And even when we are facing difficulty and going through hard times that we sometimes do not understand, the Lord is faithful. And I hope that you were reminded of that in the life of Joseph. Recordamos que el Señor es fiel. En medio de las dificultades, el Señor continúa siendo fiel todo el tiempo. If you would like somebody to pray with you, we will have some people up here in the front that would love to pray for you. I would love to meet you out there in the lobby. And as we say in Harris en Español, when you go out this week, ustedes son amados. You are loved.